Hello and welcome to the second webinar on BioVigil's webinar series, Hand Hygiene Compliance and HII Risk, a Professional versus Personal Perspective. I'm your host today, Amanda Holden-Sinisi. BioVigil's webinar series features key opinion leaders who are making a significant impact with patient safety and experience in hospitals. Speakers will share data insights and best practices that have made their organizations best in class in the culture of safety and driving exceptional patient experiences. I'm very proud to announce Brent Nibarger, today's speaker and a featured speaker for the National Safety Movement, steering committee member for Echo Health, as well as my colleague here at BioVigil. Without further ado, Brent Nibarger and Hand Hygiene Compliance and HII Risk, a Professional versus Personal Perspective.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm going to spend the next few minutes just sort of sharing a story that is coming from both a personal and professional standpoint. As Amanda mentioned, I am an employee of BioVigil, and so that'll become relevant in the conversation. But I've also become very active in the national patient safety movement through an organization that's been in existence for a few years now that is really trying to eradicate preventable harm and death from the patient care scene. But I'm also going to share with you a personal story. It's a tragic story about how I came very face-to-face to the HII problem and related implications. And you'll see how all this ties together and has kind of allowed me to have even more of a passion for solving this big looming problem than perhaps I would have had otherwise. So without further ado, let me just jump right to a little bit of background on myself. I'm not going to read this to you. You can sort of scan it as the slide is presented, but you can kind of see a little bit of my history and where I was kind of raised and kind of how my career got started. But for 35 plus years now, I've been in the med tech healthcare sector industry and doing a lot of different things. Started off in engineering product development and then kind of moved more into a sales marketing role thereafter. And I've worked for a lot of different companies, have seen lots of different patient safety improvement type technologies kind of get off the ground. And back in 2012 is when I first got introduced to BioVigil. And it was said to me that, hey, our mission in life is to really solve this long-standing kind of burdensome problem called hand hygiene compliance in hospitals and all the related HII problems that, come from that. And I was very intrigued with that mission. And so we've been on that journey for the last several years. But perhaps more personally, I have three grown sons, three daughter-in-laws, and four grandchildren. And they and I, like all of you that are listening to this webinar, are in some way, shape, form, or another a healthcare consumer. And so sooner or later, we become the recipients of most of what we all do in a professional standpoint. And that certainly was a big wake-up call and a big change of experience for me back in the 2013 timeframe, which I will share with you here shortly. So this sort of reins in a little background on my wife, Jennifer Nibarger, who sadly is no longer with us. She passed away in November of 2013 at the young age of 47. And this is really kind of where the tragedy story comes from. But I've kind of listed there a lot of things about her. In short, she was just a magical lady. Just loved by many, many, many people all over. Just had a rich, robust life, doing a lot of different things with charity organizations and being a foster parent, and also a med tech employee. You may know Masimo as a provider of pulse oximetry technologies, and a lot of respiratory monitoring technologies, and so on and so forth. So she was sort of living the industry with me, professionally speaking. In addition, some of her background I've listed here in terms of the big family she came from inside of Indiana. And she was also a nurse by training and did a lot of pediatric nursing early in her career. And then later, quality review for some of the big Blues and Aetna health plans of the world. And then, as I mentioned, got involved in the med tech space back in 2003. Well, the two of us met while working together at Medtronic, and we sort of had this long distance relationship for a number of years. And then she said, "You just got to get me out of the doom and gloom of Ohio to the sunshine out west." So we moved to Nevada in 2010, and we were married in Hawaii in 2011. And so here we were doing all this patient safety, medical technology kind of stuff in our careers. And, you know, we had this kind of 10-year fairy tale story that had evolved over those number of years. And that just abruptly came to a bit of a halt and took a significant change of course on September 2013. Sadly, we were spending a beautiful day out on the lake on our boat with family and friends. And as is often the case, things can sometimes go wrong with complex machines. And that's what happened to us. And a steering malfunction in the boat combined with the autopilot system took control of the boat out of my hands and slammed us into a rock as we were going through a canyon. And so Jennifer was thrown forward and suffered quite a number of severe injuries, and I've sort of listed them for you here on this slide. She was knocked unconscious. I suffered a concussion myself. So it was just a horrific scene. But shortly thereafter, we did get help from the National Park Service, and soon thereafter, Jennifer was airlifted to a trauma center to attend to her many injuries, as well as some other minor injuries of other passengers. But this is sort of the scene that happened to us. One moment we were having an amazing afternoon on the boat, enjoying family and friends and just some relaxation time, and the next moment we find ourselves in this setting. As I've kind of labeled the slide here, this is something you don't ever quite get over, and you always will remember in terms of, you know, how easily her life was sort of hanging in the balance at several moments, and all the injuries, internal and external, and so on and so forth. So we spent the next 4 weeks in a trauma center and endured many, many surgeries, many, many complex clinical conditions, and so on and so forth. And I'll never forget going through that time, thinking back over the years of my med tech career as well hers, how often we viewed the patient care experience through the eyes of marketing brochures that commonly had images like this, where you saw these perfectly put together patients, perfectly put together caregivers, nice colorful brochures sort of celebrating the technologies, and everyone just seemingly having a really, really good time and feeling good about what they're doing. In reality, you know, this is kind of the complexity of the world we found ourselves in for literally for a month. And I spent most every day, most every evening by Jennifer's side, slept on a cot, slept in a chair most every evening with her, surrounded by this maze of technology and beeps and buzzes and electrical lines and IV lines and medications and the so on and so forth. And I'm sure most of you on this call can relate all too well to just how complex and dangerous this scene can be, particularly if you've never seen it before and you have no idea what all this stuff is, which was not the case for me. So as you might guess, I really became sort of Jennifer's patient advocate. You know, so here we were just day after day after day dealing with a lot of complex stuff. And obviously I was trying to watchdog everything as best as I could. And I was paying particular attention to hand hygiene compliance because that was the world that I was now living in from a professional standpoint. Well, despite this being a state-of-the-art hospital and despite all the efforts of all the caregivers and myself, Jennifer, over that period of time, endured multiple infections, and I've kind of listed them there for you. And I was somewhat appalled to actually observe that probably only about 40 to 50% of the time did I actually observe people washing their hands as they came in and or as they left our patient care area. And yet everywhere the hospital was saying, hey, this is such an important thing and we've got to pay attention to this and there's lots of implications and so on. But as is the case, all of the treatment and therapies and drugs and added cost was thrown into the scene to treat these conditions that were now acquired conditions. And strangely enough, almost $1 million worth of billable charges were sent to us after her care. And so everybody got paid in full. And I just thought it was extremely strange that, a vast majority of these charges were all about treating acquired conditions rather than the things that she was admitted for. Well, 4 weeks later, we had thought we had gotten over the hill and we were on our way to recovery. And as you can see here, Jennifer was looking amazingly better than she did 4 weeks prior. And here's a picture of us being transported to an LTAC, to a step-down unit where she was going to start some of her recovery process. And we really thought we had made it, over this mountain. But as so often is the case, you get into a scene like that and then other complications begin to show up. So we saw some surgical site infections, a peg port infection, and some other respiratory complications show up that resulted in us getting admitted into a third hospital. At that point in time, we spent another 2 weeks aggressively treating those conditions and related complications, and about another $500,000 worth of billable charges was incurred, again, all addressing these acquired conditions. Well, here we are again 2 weeks later thinking, hey, we're home free. Here's a picture of Jennifer and I and her nurse actually walking the patient floor. She's pretty well disconnected from everything. She's actually up and able to go to the restroom on her own. She's beginning to eat ice chips and applesauce and things like this. And we were told that we were going to be going home on Wednesday. And so this was a Sunday night, actually, when this photograph was taken. Well, here we are thinking we're ready to go home, and we were told that Jennifer had to pass a barium swallow test Monday morning. And so I hadn't worked for almost 2 months at this point in time, and this was the one moment that I left her side to attend to some work situations. And while I was gone, the barium test took place and was seen to migrate from her esophagus into her trach and down into her lungs. And so immediately, this was the OMG moment where all of her caregivers began to understand that she had produced a TEF, which is a trach esophageal fistula condition in her throat. So this is not a good thing. Certainly it's treatable with surgery and so on and so forth. But I wasn't there to provide kind of the moment-to-moment patient advocacy that I had for the 2 months prior. And so she got handed off to multiple units and to multiple floors, multiple caregivers. And unfortunately, that evening, they put her back on a positive pressure ventilator and began pumping her, what they thought was pumping her lungs full of air to give her some relief from the respiratory distress that was triggered. And but sadly, there was no isolation precautions taken of that hole that had been diagnosed between the trach and the esophagus. So this became the nightmare scenario. I won't read all of this to you. You can sort of scan it. But in short, for the next 6 hours, they blew her full of air while they were increasing the O2 concentration, the cycle rate of the respirator, not really paying attention to all the other vital signs, not doing blood gases and end-tidal CO2 monitoring. And the air that was being pumped into her, sadly, went into her abdomen, into her belly, and swelled her up like a balloon instead of her lungs. And they were dismissing the anxiety of this process during that time. They were dismissing her condition as as anxiety. And instead of addressing what was really going on, they were loading her up with Ativan, which further complicated the scene. And so at midnight that evening, she underwent a cardiac arrest. And the rapid response team tried to revive her, which they did get a heartbeat back after a long, prolonged period of time. But unfortunately, by the time that it occurred, extensive brain damage had occurred that was completely non-recoverable. So 3 weeks later, sustained life support, neurological testing, and so on and so forth, it became clear that there was just no hope for any kind of recovery. But it was just curious to me how there seemed to be really no consequence to what had happened. No one wanted to talk about it. No one addressed it. No one wanted to really speak to the how and why of it. And so I'm sad to say that on November 19th, we finally just had enough and had to terminate the life support, which ended her life. And to this day, the only thing that was ever said to me was that this should not have ever have happened. But again, another $500,000 worth of charges, and everyone got paid in full. So unfortunately, the beautiful story of what Jennifer is and was to me became, you know, a story where no longer was she what I had known, but she became a past tense story. And so this was very traumatic. It took me a long time to talk about it, but I've since tried to turn that story into something positive. And I've tried to understand how could it happen. I will just tell you that here are 4,600 pages of her medical record. Only one page within that record talks about that TEF condition. So it's not too hard to understand how that could easily get overlooked and missed and so on and so forth. And I think it's fair to say that the caregivers at the time just had no idea that she had that condition. If they had, they never would have done what they had done. So in summary, $2.1 million worth of hospital charges, about half of that was spent treating these acquired conditions. I did go so far as to file a quality of grievance complaint with the health plan, but they said they couldn't really talk about what they may or may not have found. And, you know, often people think, well, gee, somebody needs to be held responsible, so maybe I should sue. But oddly, in the state of Nevada, your life's only worth $350,000, and you got to find a legal team to go chase it, which they want about half of it to do so. But they wouldn't even take the case because of the underlying complications and infection risk, which they say are too difficult to prove and to win. So that seemed like a dead-end street. So what do we have here? Well, we have a condition where everyone thought they were doing the right thing, but the system sort of like all lined up, as they say, the Swiss cheese, all the holes lined up, and a worst possible scenario occurred. And so a lot of loss, you know, personally, professionally. I mean, we all lost in this scenario. And unfortunately, this is the story that happens about 560 times per day. And that's really what compelled me to become involved with the patient safety movement. 200,000 related deaths occur every year in U.S. hospitals from preventable causes. And a classic case, of course, is Jennifer's. And so I've been trying to use that story as a platform for change. I've done a video about it, which I'll give you the reference to, and so on and so forth. But in conclusion, this is certainly a story that none of us would ever expect or we would think is deserved, yet it's repeated hundreds of times across our country every day. And so now what I sort of gave you the stats and figures here about, you know, kind of how often this occurs and the cost of the healthcare system and so on and so forth. But take a look at the HAI data. You know, preventable deaths is one thing, but then there is this HAI dilemma that every one of you sees and deals with on a daily basis. That's another 700,000 patients per year that are being impacted by these acquired infections. Of those, 75,000 people die from them per year. And what we know to be true is that these are largely attributable, not exclusively attributable, but largely to a never-ending hand hygiene compliance problem. And so we have to take a step back and ask ourselves, you know, how is it that we've come to tolerate these kinds of statistics and these kinds of conditions in what is supposed to be an industry that, you know, we sort of take it at face value that it's first and foremost about patient safety. And how does this continue to happen year after year? And what do we do about it? And why isn't there more of a public outcry? And why are so many of these patient safety improvement efforts sort of all being done at more of a grassroots level rather than a systematic level? So these are interesting questions that I'm not going to try to answer here. But I think it's fair to say that when we look at this, sooner or later, we have to recognize that we're going to be the ones in the hospital bed, or it's going to be our loved ones. And this really changes our perspective on just about everything. So we need to be proactive about this and really understand, what are we going to do if and when we become the recipient of kind of this healthcare industry that can, in large part, make for a dangerous situation. So I would suggest to you that having a patient safety advocate and really watching over what's happening to you is a must. You know, really do your due diligence on the care that's being provided and how that's being organized and so on and so forth. And so these are just some important questions to maybe consider as we think about this. But I would also ask you to think about this one. Are the economic incentives lined up properly to really address these basic patient safety problems? I would suggest to you that I don't think they are. If $1 million worth of billable charges were spent on Jennifer's case, over half of it for acquired conditions that everyone gets paid in full, and yet we all got handed the worst possible outcome, one has to kind of scratch their head and say, are things lined up the right way? So taking a step back again and looking more microscopically at the hand hygiene compliance problem, you know, what we know to be true here is that the average 200-bed hospital is actually should be delivering some 18 to 20,000 hand hygiene events on a daily basis. And we know that this is foundational to any and all infection prevention efforts, because if this is done right, there's big benefits. If it's done poorly, there are many, many implications. But the fact of the matter is, we're still chasing this problem the same old way. And if we continue to do that, we'll never fix it. So I'm shifting gears a little bit now from my personal story to the professional story. And that is to say that we've got to have a different conversation. We've got to start thinking about how to change this hand hygiene compliance culture that we see to be so prevalent across hospitals and care areas across the country. And you're not going to fix this with more audits and secret shoppers. So we've got to have a different tool. And we have to also have a different conversation that says, how do we reprioritize where we're spending money, how we're spending money, and what the expectations are? And I would suggest to you that this doesn't work, even though it has for many, many decades kind of been a standard talk track, which is to say, hey, let's engage the patient in this hand hygiene compliance issue, and let's empower them not to be afraid to ask if it's being done. Well, if that worked, we wouldn't have the problem that we have today across the country. So we know that these kinds of approaches are largely completely ineffective. We also know that hand hygiene compliance monitoring has a big, big, big economic cost implication, as well as a quality and outcome implication. And this particular study is a pretty darn good one. It was put out in 2014 that really unpacks the economics of this issue and gives many, many references and lots of economic examples about what happens when this is done well and what happens when this is done not so well. And certainly there's 150 years of supporting research out there that makes the associated link between hand hygiene compliance and infection risk reduction. So the science and the evidence is overwhelmingly in support of it. And of course, each of you on the phone today are living increasingly in a accountable care environment where the quality and financial implications of really getting your arms around these risks continues to go up and becomes more problematic each and every year. And I won't try to unpack all of that. I'm sure you're all too aware of these implications, whether it's Medicare hack rate penalties, value-based purchasing, safety domain rankings, SIR scores, leapfrog scores, and the like. So we got to do something. And interestingly, Joint Commission just recently, January 1 of this year, really raised the performance bar on this topic to all new levels. And I'm sure most of you are aware of this change of position where now if they survey your hospital and they observe anyone doing patient care who doesn't do proper hand hygiene, it's an immediate RFI citation. So they're not going to ask anymore about how you're going to make this better. It's really going to become much more punitive in nature. So this is really the essence for why BioVigil came to be and what we're doing and how we do it. We've been at this about 6 years. It took a number of years and a lot more time and money to really figure this out than we ever imagined. But our single focus in that effort was to really solve this problem on a continuous 24/7, 365 basis and to provide a tool that ensures that 100% compliance is not only achieved, but sustained. And I'm happy to report to you that we now have many, many clients across the country that have demonstrated and proven this to be true, and hundreds of millions of data points to back that up. Not surprisingly, when you fix this fundamental problem, our client base reports anywhere from a 30 to 83% reduction in the overall infection rates in those settings. So this validates the 150 years worth of science that we spoke of earlier. But this has never been seen before and never been achievable inside of a busy hospital until now. So there are other things listed here that also talk about what happens with a system like this in terms of how it changes the culture, improves patient safety levels. And really, the big takeaway is that it just improves the overall clinical, operational, and financial performance of the hospital across the board. And we don't have a lot of time to unpack all this in great detail, but I just want to give you a couple of sort of snippets about the how and why that it's so effective. And it turns out the simplicity of a traffic light approach really became the key to everything. Here you see some nurses wearing this little badge that is worn while they're on shift. On the face of this badge is an active status light, a little LED illuminated hand symbol that actively changes from green to yellow to red, depending on the hand hygiene status of a patient engagement process and or upon the sort of exit event from a patient care area. So the visualization turned out to be a very empowering, kind of key, impactful component of this. As well, the system automatically reminds people to do hand hygiene if they forget. And then we use a vibration feature, which is optional, and an audible tone feature for the user. That's the reminder sequence. And the visualization part is really confirming to patients and family members at the point of care that it's actually being done. So when you combine these two things, it's just quite amazing the transformation that it makes. And it's not something that takes weeks or months. It literally transforms the performance of an entire hospital overnight. So the summary of the how and why of the system are sort of listed here. Obviously, these become pretty apparent. And we just know that once this goes into a hospital, no one ever thinks about going back to the old way of trying to keep track of hand hygiene performance. And patients get very vocal about the value that they see in this, and they talk about it quite heavily. We've seen lots of media coverage about this and so on and so forth. And so we really know this works, and we would just encourage you to think about what its potential application may be in your clinical setting. And we are all too aware that we know you're out there fighting this battle every day. And so I would just encourage you to really speak the truth about the ongoing limitations of hand hygiene compliance in today's setting and all of its related implications, and not to let some of the common organizational budgetary hurdles sort of discourage you from speaking that truth. And clearly, we've got to think outside of the box about how to solve this problem that I've been hearing about for 35 years of my career, and I think most of you probably struggle with on a daily, weekly, or at least on a monthly basis amongst your care teams. And the truth of the matter is, we now have the technology to solve this problem. And so I would encourage you to join me and to join our cause about really being more diligent about that, because this ultimately is about protecting your patients, but ultimately it's about protecting yourself and your family members and other loved ones. And clearly, if we do a better job of improving patient safety, this is good for all of our business interest as well. So we can make a difference, and I would encourage you to just find your personal inspiration and be a change agent. For me, that's Jennifer's story, and the ongoing story, of course, is my three sons, their wives, and these four precious grandchildren of mine. So with that, I will conclude and simply point you to two things. If you'd like to learn more about what I'm trying to do, and a lot of other people across the country and around the world really are trying to do in this regard, check out patientsafetymovement.org. And there's a tab under that website labeled Patient Stories. And I did a video about Jennifer's story there that you can refer to, along with many, many, many other patient stories that are listed there. But that's a really good resource for how we're trying to affect change across many, many different patient safety domains, hand hygiene being just one of them. And then, of course, do look us up at biovigil.com for more information about what we're doing to solve this problem in the hands of many clients across the country. And I encourage you to learn more about the details of our system and its related impact. So Amanda, I think with that, I'm done, and I'll turn it back to you.
Okay, Brent, thanks so much. If you have a couple of extra minutes, we do have a couple of questions that were submitted. So of course, if we can't answer these now, we can do it over email, but I thought I would bring them to your attention. There is one question about, could you talk to the resistance of wearing a badge due to tracking concerns? So I think this is probably in regards to nurses and techs wearing badges and thinking that they're being watched by Big Brother.
Sure. Well, I would first say, there's always this pushback of, oh my gosh, I got to wear this little badge, and I don't want to wear more gizmos. I'm already wearing an ID badge, a stethoscope. Maybe I've got a Voicera communicator, and so on and so forth. Well, that's true. But the fact of the matter is, the little badge is solving a very fundamental patient safety quality improvement issue that cannot be solved any other way. So what most of our clients do is they just adopt a policy that says when you're working, you will wear the BioVigil badge the same way you are to wear your hospital ID badge. And so policy is first and foremost, as is leadership and communication. Now, this other issue of, gee, this feels like Big Brother and it's tracking me and so on and so forth, most of that came from prior technologies that were called asset tracking technologies that saw everybody and anything, no matter where it went throughout a hospital, and people kind of got a little nudgy about that, and they often like to say that this is the same thing. It's not. This tool only knows if and when someone walks into a patient care area that's being monitored and when you walk out. And it only keeps track of the alert sequence, and then if and when you then followed that with hand hygiene activity. So it is a tool that is literally and exclusively only designed to do that one thing. So this tool does not keep track of how much time you spend at the nursing station. It does not know if you go to the bathroom. It doesn't know if you take a break. It doesn't know if you're in the cafe or the break room or anything else like that. We're only trying to solve the hand hygiene problem, and that's it. So if you were to take a deeper look at our data that comes out of the system on the back end, you would see very clearly that there are many metrics within hand hygiene, but that is the only thing that is observed. So our clients often have some of that concern on the front end. They use the system and they then celebrate the fact that we no longer have to have the conversations about, are we doing the right thing for hand hygiene? Are we in compliance with the policy? Are we meeting Joint Commission standards? We now have the data to prove that we're doing that 24/7, 365.
Thank you, Brent. There's another question regarding this topic, and that is, doesn't it in some ways move the audit from hand hygiene itself to auditing for the badge presence? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Good question. In some respects, it does do exactly that. But, you know, we're moving from a manual audit secret shopper hand hygiene activity, which we know is woefully inadequate, where not even a 0.5% of actual observations are ever captured. And so the reporting process of that is completely biased and is not painting a true and accurate picture whatsoever, not to mention all the Hawthorne effect and other biases that kind of, you know, fit into that picture. So we're moving to a badge-based system. So one might ask, well, how do you go about auditing compliance of the badge user to actual badge wearing? Well, the system actually does that automatically. So every user is wirelessly paired to a badge when they pick it up by way of a little key fob device that clips onto the back of their user ID badge. So we know when people are on shift, and we know whether they're wearing the badge or they are not. And if they, for some reason, choose not to do that in a purposeful way, that automatically shows up on an exception report. But the reality is, you're changing the culture. So if you're informing patients as to what this tool is and what the expectation is, and somebody then decides, I'm not going to wear the badge, it just stands out like a red thumb. Coworker to coworker, but also healthcare provider to the patient. So we just don't see that problem be a long-term issue. We may see some of that compliance problem to be present in the first few days, but soon thereafter, it just goes away because of the culture transformation.
Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. And I think this next question kind of also rides the coattails of the culture discussion, and that is, how is this handled for staff who are not employed by the hospital, specifically physicians, who may not necessarily have a badge assigned? I think you kind of hinted about
Steve. Sure. Yeah, we get that one a lot. And I would tell you the scene is a little different in the hospitals where the physicians are sort of privileged and are rounding community-based folks who kind of come and go willy-nilly versus the employed physicians who are on staff. Those folks are real easy to get on board for all the obvious reasons. It's the privileged rounding ones that are a little tougher. Keep in mind that the badge is not checked out individually. So the badges are shared by any and all users. They're picked up from base stations that are located throughout the hospital. So from a physician who might be entering and exiting the hospital at various locations in time, the badges can be easily grabbed when they come in for rounding and dropped off at a different location. They do not have to go back to the same area. And when they wear the badge only during their rounding, it automatically would again pair to them, as is the case with a normal staff. But I would tell you this, Most of our clients find that we onboard the system first and foremost with nursing staff and also ancillary support departments. I wouldn't fight the physician adoption battle right up front. We recommend giving that 30, 60, maybe 90 days at the outside. And what happens is physicians get on board very quickly because they get tired of answering the question from patients and family members why they're not wearing the badge while every other caregiver in the hospital is. And it just turns out that the doctors 30, 60, 90 days into a post-implementation condition start asking to get their little wireless key fob so that they can just check out badges when they're doing rounds. And that just is the way that it normally takes care of itself. And then they become part of the solution like everybody else, because as we all often hear, many people will say that physicians can sometimes be some of the worst culprits in terms of hand hygiene compliance. And so this is just a way to get everybody to raise the tide on all boats so that the quality level is consistent across the board.
Okay. Well, with that, we have no further questions. So, Brent, I'd like to thank you again, and I'm sure everyone on the phone also thanks you for sharing your story about Jennifer and your suggestions about how to be a patient advocate. I think that's really important. And for those of you who are listening, feel free to join us for BioVigil's next webinar, which will be held on May 31st, also at 2 p.m. Eastern. This will be with Nafia Reed, who will be sharing a nurse's perspective on hand hygiene compliance. And with that, I thank you all for joining, and we'll see you next time.